Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to look at how to find isoelectric point, or PI, for amino acids. The isoelectric point comes from iso, meaning the same, and electric, meaning charge. The isoelectric point is the point at which the amino acid has the same charge, or rather a net charge of zero. In the last video, we saw how to find the charge for glycine at different pH values and called this structure when we have a plus and minus on the same molecule as zwitterion. Notice that in this form, we don't have no charge, but rather we have a charge of plus one and minus one that cancel out to give me zero. If this is the structure where we have an isoelectric point, then the PI is really the pH of I, meaning the pH at which we have a net charge of zero. In the last video, we looked specifically at the charge for glycine at a pH of 1, 7, and 13. At a pH of 1, we got a net charge of plus 1. pH of 7, we got a charge of 0. And pH of 13, we got a charge of negative 1. If the pH 7 gives me a charge of 0, does this mean that the isoelectric point is 7? And the answer is no. pH of 7 is simply an estimate where it could be slightly greater than or slightly less than with an average charge of 0. The PI is a more specific calculated value, and so we have to look at how to find it mathematically. Let's prove it by adding one more value and finding the charge at a pH of 8. Don't forget that we have two pKa values for glycine. pKa for the carboxy is equal to 2.3, and pKa for the amine group is equal to 9.6. If we're looking at a pH of 8, we have to compare the pKa to the pH, remembering that the higher one wins. The pKa wins a proton for team molecule. The pH wins a proton for team solution. For the amine group, the pKa is greater than the pH, and that means the pKa wins a proton for team molecule. The molecule is protonated, and we have a charge of plus 1 on the amine group. Looking at the carboxy, the pH is much greater than the pKa, and the pH wins the proton for the solution, which means we take it away from the molecule. The carboxy group will be deprotonated for a charge of negative 1. If we add them up, we have plus 1 minus 1 equals 0. So which is it? Is the PI going to be a pH of 7, or will it be a pH of 8, given that both of these pH values give us a net charge of 0? If an amino acid does not have an ionizable side chain, that means it only has two pKa values, one for the carboxy, one for the amine, then you simply take the average of the two pKa values, which is pKa1 plus pKa2 divided by 2. To find the PI for glycine, we add 2.3 plus 9.6 and divided by 2. Remember, on the MCAT you have no calculator, so we'll use the round up and down trick from the MCAT math series link below. 2.3 rounds down to 2, 9.6 rounds up to 10, 2 and 10 is 12, divide that by 2 and I get 6. The calculator gives me a value of 5.95, which on the MCAT is close enough. Notice that 5.95, or 6, is less than 7 and less than 8, but it is that range where we have a charge of 0, and the isoelectric point gives us an exact calculated value. That method is great when the amino acid has only two pKa values, but what happens if we have three? For example, in tyrosine here, we have the carboxy and the amine that can gain or lose a proton, but we also have an ionizable side chain where the oxygen can lose a hydrogen. If we have three pKa values, do we average all three? If we only use two, which two do we use? Before I show you how to do this mathematically, I want to show you logically so that you understand where we're getting the values. Remember, to find the PI, we need to know exactly where the molecule is going to have a net charge of zero. If we compare the pH to the pKa values, you'll be able to figure out when it's protonated or deprotonated, and you can do the guess and check method, where you randomly pick a pH and determine what the charge is going to be, or you can go through this logically. I'm going to show you how to write it out, but on the MCAT you should be able to do this in your head. We're going to rank the pKa values from low to high, so we have 2.2, 9.1, and 10.1. Remember that when the pKa is greater than the pH, the pKa grabs the proton for the molecule. When the pH is greater than the pKa, the pH, the solution, grabs one from the molecule for the solution, meaning it's deprotonated. So if we were to compare what the molecule looks like in between the pKa values, you'll notice the trend. Start out by fully protonating the molecule and finding the charge. How do you fully protonate? You drop the pH well below the first pKa value. If the lowest pKa is 2.2, let's drop the pH to 1. At a pH of 1, every pKa is greater than the pH, meaning every group is protonated. So we get a hydrogen for a neutral charge, a hydrogen for a positive charge, and another hydrogen neutral. Fully protonated, we get a charge of plus 1. Remember the trick I showed you in a previous video, where as you raise the pH between pKa units, the charge goes down by 1, down by 1. If we raise the charge to the next in-between value, meaning above the first pKa, we're going to lose one proton and the charge will drop from plus 1 to 0. Which one do I deprotonate first? Well, if the pH is somewhere in between, let's set it to 5. That means the pH is now greater than this pKa value. The pH wins the battle of the proton and steals it for the solution. That gives me a negative 1 over here. That's how we get 0. Plus 1, minus 1, and 0 for a net charge of 0. If we were to raise the pH greater than the next pKa value, in this case we have to go in between 9.1 and 10.1, for example a pH of 9.6, we're going to get a half protonated deprotonated value for the 9.1 and the 10.1, but again the trick is we drop the charge by 1, that's negative 1, and raising it well above 10.1, for example pH is equal to 13, it should be negative 2. Let's prove it by showing what it looks like at 13. pH 13 is greater than 2.2. The pH wins 1 for the solution. We have a deprotonated carboxy with a charge of minus 1. pH 13 is greater than 9.1, so we deprotonate, get NH2, a lone pair but no charge. pH 13 is greater than 10.1, so we deprotonate the alcohol and get a charge of negative 1. If we add it up, we have negative 1, negative 1, and 0 for a charge of negative 2 as we predicted. How does this help us figure out the isoelectric point? The isoelectric point is the average of the two pKa values that are just before and just after 0. If the guesstimate here of pH 5 gives us a charge of 0, that means that when the pH is equal to the pKa at 2.2, we would expect to have the charge of plus 1/2. When the pH is 9.1 at the next pKa value, we would expect a charge of minus 1/2. And the in-between of plus 1/2 and minus 1/2 is 0. So if we take the structure in between those two pKa values, that is where we expect to see the isoelectric point. To figure this out mathematically, we simply say that the pI is equal to 2.2 plus 9.1 divided by 2. Remember, without a calculator, we're going to estimate. In this case, it's easy to add the exact values. 2 and 9 is 11, 0.2 and 0.1 is 0.3, divide that by 2. This is difficult to do, so we can round this up to 11.4. 11 divided by 2 is 5.5, 0.4 gives me 0.2, and that means we have 5.7. If that was too hard for you, just round 11.3 up to 12, divide that by 2, and you get 6. Knowing that you rounded up, your answer should be rounded slightly down, and 5.7 is slightly less than 6. Many professors will teach you to simply take the two closest pKa values and average them, so I want to show you why that's incorrect. The two closest pKa values for tyrosine are 9.1 and 10.1. If we take the average of 9.1 and 10.1, we get 9 and 10, which is 19.2, and we divide that by 2. Let's estimate. Let's round it up to 20 divided by 2 is equal to 10. Let's see what happens to this amino acid at a pH of 10. pH 10 is greater than 2.2, wins 1 for the solution, we deprotonate and get a negative 1. pH 10 is 1 greater than 9.1, we're going to estimate that it's an exact protonation-deprotonation instead of looking at the buffer zone. 10 is greater than 9, deprotonate, win 1 for the solution, and that gives me a neutral nitrogen. And finally, at a pH of 10, 10.1 is close enough. We can put this at a buffer So it'll be somewhere between negative 1 and 0 because it'll be an H or a negative, and that gives me negative 1 half. Keep in mind we estimated, but we only estimated a little bit. And when we add these up, we get a negative 1 for the carboxy, 0 for the nitrogen, and negative 1 half for the ionizable side chain. This gives me a net charge of negative 1.5, which even with a slight margin of error for our estimations, is still not zero. That means this is not the isoelectric point. So that trick of averaging the two closest values doesn't always work, and if you memorize it without understanding, you will mess up. Can we prove that our calculated value is indeed correct? Let's see. 5.7, let's estimate that to 6 and see what the charge looks like. pH of 6 is greater than the pKa, pH wins a proton for the solution, and we get a negative 1. pH of 6 is less than the pKa of 9.1, the pKa wins 1 for the molecule, and we have a protonated amine for a charge of plus 1. pH of 6 is less than a pKa of 10.1, and the pKa wins 1 for the molecule, giving us a protonated side chain. When we add up the charges, we have minus 1, plus 1, and 0, for a net charge of 0, which is what we expect at the isoelectric point. Now that you understand how to do it, let's see the trick when you're given 3 pKa values for an amino acid. When you protonate the R group, or the amino acid side chain, you have two outcomes. If the atom that gets protonated is oxygen or sulfur, you're going to get a neutral protonated group. You'll see this for your acidic amino acids, aspartic acid, and glutamic acid. You'll also see it for the non-acidic basic ionizable side chains, cysteine and tyrosine. If you protonate the R group that has a nitrogen, it's going to get a positive charge, and these refer to your basic amino acids, which include histidine, arginine, and lysine. If you're not comfortable with this, look at the structures, protonate all your side chains, and find the charge of that variable group. The two options we're comparing are 0 versus plus 1, where 0 is lower and plus 1 is higher. If the protonated side chain is neutral, for a charge of 0, it's the lower value, you're going to use the lower two pKa values. If the protonated R group is plus 1, that's the upper, so you're going to use the upper two pKa values. That means, for aspartic acid, glutamic acid, cysteine, and tyrosine, you're going to use the pKa of the carboxy group and the side chain. For histidine, arginine, and lysine, you're going to use the pKa of the amine group and the side chain. And that is how you're going to get your isoelectric point. Let's prove this trick by looking at aspartic acid for our neutral protonated group and lysine for our positive protonated group. Aspartic acid, or aspartate, has a CH2 followed by a carboxy in its side chain. pKa values will differ depending on the book or source you're referring to, but the concept is the same. So just look at the values you're given and apply the same trick. The pKa for the carboxy side chain is 2.1, amine side chain is 9.8, and variable group is 3.9. The trick is, when the protonated R group is neutral, we use the lower two values. If we protonate the side chain, we get an OH which has no charge, so let's see what the lower two values are. The pi is equal to, the lower two values would be 2.1 and 3.9. We'll round 2.1 down to 2, 3.9 up to 4, 2 and 4 is 6, divided by 2 is equal to 3. We expect the pi to be 3. Let's prove it by finding the charge of this amino acid at a pH of 3. When the pH is 3 and we compare a 2.1 pKa, the pH is greater than the pKa and wins 1 for the solution. We're still in the buffer zone, but we're going to estimate a complete deprotonation for a charge of negative 1. At a pH of 3, the pKa 9.8 is greater than the pH, wins 1 for the molecule, and we get a protonated NH3+, giving us plus 1. And finally, the pKa of the side chain is greater than the pH of 3. We're still in the buffer zone, but we're going to estimate a complete protonation. When the pKa is greater than the pH, we win a proton for the molecule, giving us a charge of 0. If we add them up, negative 1 plus 1 plus 0 gives us a net charge of 0, which is exactly what we expect for the molecule when the pH is equal to the isoelectric point. In case you need to see it the long way again, let me show you the trick written out. We line up the pK values. We have 2.1, 3.9, and 9.8. If we drop the pH to 1, it's lower than the lowest pKa. Everything would be fully protonated. This would be plus 1, this would be 0, and this would be 0. We get a net charge of positive 1. If we jump to the next value, we would drop from plus 1 down to 0, down to negative 1, down to negative 2. We get 0 in between 2.1 and 3.9. That means we averaged these two to get the pI, which is exactly what we did. For our upper example, let's look at lysine, which has 4 CH2 groups in its side chain and an amine group. We'll write it as NH2. The pKa values are 2.2 for the carboxy, 8.9 for the parent amine, and 10.8 for the R group. Since lysine, when protonated, will give me NH3+, or an upper value, we have to average the upper two pKa values to get the isoelectric point. pI is equal to 8.9 plus 10.8 divided by 2. We're going to round 8.9 up to 9, round 10.8 up to 11. 9 and 11 gives me 20, divided by 2 gives me 10. Keep in mind, because we rounded both values up, our answer is going to be slightly less than 10. The calculator gives me 9.85, which on the MCAT is definitely close enough. Let's prove it by finding the charge of this molecule at a pH of just under 10. The pH is greater than the carboxy pKa, which means it wins one for the solution, deprotonate the molecule, and get a charge of negative 1. A pH of slightly less than 10 is greater than 8.9, and when the pH is greater, it wins one for the solution, deprotonate, and we get a neutral backbone nitrogen. And finally, a pKa of 10.8 is greater than the pH slightly under 10, and when the pKa is greater, it wins one for the molecule, so we have NH3+ for the side chain. That gives me a charge of plus 1. When we add it up, we have minus 1 plus 0 plus 1, which is equal to 0, and that is the charge expected at the isoelectric point. Let's try this with the long way trick. We have 2.2, 8.9, and 10.8. Fully protonated at a pH of 1, we would have a protonated nitrogen, another protonated nitrogen that's plus 2, and 0 for the carboxy side chain when it's OH. That would give me a charge of plus 2 fully protonated. Jump to the next pKa value, you'd get a charge of plus 1 because we drop a point. The next one gives me 0, and fully deprotonated would give me negative 1. When the pH is somewhere between 8.9 and 10.8, we have a charge of 0, and this is what we expect to average to get the isoelectric point. This is what we used to get a pH of just under 10 with a molecule having a charge of 0. Be sure to join me in the next video where we look at how to find the charge and isoelectric point for polypeptides ranging from 2, 3, or more bound amino acids. You can find this entire video series along with my amino acids practice quiz and cheat sheet by visiting my website, leahforsci.com/aminoacids.